Hi, welcome to Learning Monkey. I am Vikram. In this class, we'll try to understand modes of transfer. So in that, we are going to understand about programmed I/O. The concept of programmed I/O has already been discussed in our previous videos. In our first section of this computer organization, where we have discussed about basic computer organization, in those concepts, we have discussed about programmed I/O concept. If you haven't watched those videos, please watch those videos and come back here. And every video in our channel is going to be part of entire course a playlist. Our suggestion is to follow the entire course so that you can have better understanding of the concepts, and the link for the playlist is provided in the description below. Now coming to this class, we will try to understand about programmed I/O. Before that, what is this modes of transfer? Modes of transfer means whenever the I/O device has some content to be transferred, so that content has to be transferred onto the memory. For example, if the I/O device, let's assume that we have an I/O device. This is an I/O device, and this I/O device, whenever it has some content, assume that this is a keyboard. Whenever a key on the keyboard get pressed, so the ASCII value of that key, the ASCII value of that key has to be transferred onto the memory. So whenever, because why it has to be transferred onto the memory is because the content that has been transferred by the I/O device may be used by the program in some other time. So for that reason, that content, every content that has been transferred, that has been that the I/O wants to transfer, that has to be transferred onto the memory. That transfer can be done either through the CPU, that can be done through the CPU, or that can be done directly into the memory. So directly the content will get transferred onto the memory. So those kind of transfers, so there are three different kinds of modes of transfers. So that transfer can be done in three different ways. So all you need to understand is the transfer of data that the I/O want to send onto the memory, that transfer can be done in three different ways. So those three different ways are programmed I/O, interrupt initiated I/O, and the other one is direct memory access. In this class, we will try to understand about programmed I/O. The concept of programmed I/O has already been discussed. There we have discussed about, we have seen the lines of code which are used by the CPU, which continuously run by the CPU to identify whether the content, the data provided by the I/O device is present in the I/O register or not. So the CPU is going to continuously check. So what happens in the programmed I/O is, let's try to understand it with the diagram, block diagram of the programmed I/O. So this is how the program I/O will be, in the sense whenever the I/O device send some data, what happens is, whenever we press a key on the keyboard, better way is to understand with keyboard. So whenever a key on the keyboard is pressed, so it sends the data through data valid. So the content that the ASCII codes that are required to be transferred, so that transfer is done by using this data valid concept. So this concept has already been discussed in our previous videos. Okay, so valid data is transferred, and that is received at the data I/O interface. This is I/O interface. As and when the data is received by the I/O interface, it will get stored onto the data register, and immediately what the I/O interface will do is, this I/O interface will make this flag bit. Initially this flag bit is 0. Whenever the data is transferred, simultaneously what this I/O interface will do is, this flag bit is made to 1. So this is what we call it a status register. In the status register, we will be having different status bits. Among those status bits, one of the bit is F. F means flag bit is set to 1, which means that the I/O data, the data related to the I/O devices is ready for transfer. So now what the CPU will do is, the CPU will continuously check for this I/O register, so status register. So what the CPU will do is, CPU will run two lines of code. Those two lines of code, what they will do is, they will continuously fetch the data from the status register, and they will check whether the FBT is one or not. So first line of code, what it will do is it will fetch the data onto the CPU. Status register data will be fetched onto the CPU, and in the second line of code it is going to check whether the FBT is one. If the FBT is one, which means that the data is ready for the transfer. The data is ready for the transfer. If the FBT is not set, what it means is, so we have to wait for the IO device to transfer the data from IO device to this data register. So that program, the two lines of program we have discussed there. So the two lines of code, what they will check is, they will check for the status register, and in that state they will fetch the status register. In that status register, if FBT is made as one, which means that the data register, the content in the data register can be fetched and can be transferred onto the memory. Okay, so this continuous process has to be done by using this programmed IO. So this is how the programmed IO will work. But what are those lines of code that needs to be run by the programmed IO is here. So these are the lines of code that needs to be done. First, read the status register. So here what we have to do is, we have to read the status register, and this status register read from the status, the content of the status register read from the, is fetched by the CPU. Check the status of the flag bit. So we have to check for this flag bit and branch to step one if not set. If the flag bit is not set, not set means zero. If the flag bit is zero, again go to the first line of code. So we have to go to this first line of code, and again we have to fetch the status bit. Again we have to read the status register content. Again we have to check for the flag bit. If it is not set, again we have to go into. So this process has to be done continuously. This process has to be done continuously. The third line of code is, if the status bit is set to one. If the status bit is set to 1, read the data register. So the content of data register can be read. Okay, so until the status bit is set to 1, we have to check the status register content continuously. If the status register F bit is set to 1, then we can get the content of the data register. So what is the problem with this programmed IO? So everything is fine. So we are going to get the data from the IO devices, and that data can be read, and it can be used, it can be transferred onto the memory. But what is the problem is, the efficiency of the CPU will get reduced. In what way? In what way means, what is the speed of the CPU? CPU will work in million instructions per second or million instructions per second will be run by the CPU. For example, so the problem with the IO devices is, the IO devices runs very slow. For example, if you take keyboard, how many number of keys can we press per second? Per second, at most we can press 5 keys, or at most we can press 10 keys. So those 10 keys, in order to transfer the content of that 10 keys means we need just 10 instructions for transfer. But per second, how many instructions are run for that IO, for the checking of that IO? So we are going to run 500,000 instructions. So 1 million instructions per second. It means that 500 per second. So we are going to run the IO. These two values, lines of code, if we run per second, so 500,000 instructions. 500,000 instructions, or so this instruction will be this particular instruction will be run for 500,000 times, and this instruction is going to run for 500,000 times. So completely the efficiency of the CPU is wasted upon running the lines of code which are of no use. So for example, if you are typing the key per second, if you're going to press the key, one key per second, so 500,000 times this instruction has to run, and another 500,000 times this instruction has to run. So the efficiency, the content, the efficiency of the CPU is wasted in running the instructions which are of no use. So that is the disadvantage that we are going to have with programmed I/O, and these concepts are not used in these days. So these days we are going to use interrupt initiated I/O and the direct memory access. So programmed I/O can be used in very slow computers. Okay, so this is all about programmed I/O. Hope you got the clarity on this concept. Thanks for watching. If you haven't subscribed to our channel, please subscribe to our channel and press bell icon for the latest updates. And if you have any doubts regarding this concept, please post your doubt in the comment section below. And if you feel that this video is helpful to you, please give us a like symbol and please share this video with your friends so that they will also get benefited. Thanks for watching.